Balcombe is a village on the borders of East and West Sussex. It's not far from the open expanse of Ashdown Forest, where Winnie the Pooh made his home. Although Gatwick Airport is close to the north, although the main Brighton to London railway line runs past the village, and although many of the fine old houses are beyond the means of the villagers and have been bought by wealthy London commuters, there's still plenty of rural calm and countryside character. Tucked away on Bowder's farm, just outside the village, is the cottage of a retired gamekeeper, Jack Lewis. Jack has lived in Balcombe for 40 years. He's fathered five children, and his four sons have followed him in earning their living from the land. Jack's knowledge and experience of country ways and country moods is broad and full of wisdom. He's retired now, and in his retirement, there's time to reflect on his childhood.
I think everybody's thoughts go back, I won't say to the all early days, but I've no doubt about it, in everybody's life, some part of the young lives were the best. I talked to a very, very, very prominent man. A matter of fact, he became Prime Minister, and I had a day with him out shooting, and he talked to me at length of his boyhood days and really enjoyed them, and so did I. And I think it's nice to look back. Whatever it's been, whether it's been rough or smooth. If it's been rough, you think, well, I did well to weather that. Oh, yeah.
Snow came to Balcombe during the winter. It brought with it inconvenience and beauty. In Jack's place, at the centre of things, there were special problems for him and for his neighbours.
There is a bewildered expression on them. They don't know what it is. And it takes days and days for them to get used to it. The main feature of the thing is, with birds and snow, they take it for granted that they're far better sitting where they are than worrying and looking for stuff. I think they accept it better than we do. I don't think the cold has much to do with it. I think they put up with a lot of cold, but they must have food. I've got some peafowls here, and they sit up the trees, and they won't come down all day. So they don't use any energy, and they can get food. I've known pheasants stop up the trees for a week. They never came down. The snow was about a foot deep. They couldn't have done anything. But those pheasants lived. There was no dead ones under the trees. I don't think I can do any more. The majority of things around here will come to where I am. I've not got to go and look for them. When one's found it, there's no doubt about it, they converse and they tell the others.
The snow disappeared as swiftly as it had come. Jack's constant companions are his three dogs, who share his home and his hours, waking and sleeping.
They're a very good
type of golden retriever. They're placid, and they're well behaved. Anna's, what, nearly 10. And I've got a 2 pups here. Angus, which is a super dog. He's nearly 5. And, of course, his sister, called several names, a damn nuisance sometimes, but usually referred to as the little one. And their main thing in life is going out shooting and sleeping. And in between, a good feed. Angus is a big, strong dog and will pick up a little chicken at a day old and he won't hurt it. And he'll bring me an egg. His mouth's so soft. This is a great part about all three of them. They don't hurt anything. We get on very well together. They're great company. They never answered me back yet.
Every January, Jack's youngest son, John, a gamekeeper like his father, starts to plan for the next pheasant shooting season, even before the current shooting season is over. First, he and his keepers must attend to the young hens who will produce next season's chicks.
We decide we're going to catch them on the right sort of weather, which is rather miserable, but the birds are hungry, so they'll go into the cages.
Right. Bring it this way a little bit so I can get round the cage. That's it, right. That's it, in you go. Right, baby, you come a bit closer. That's it. So catch the hen birds first.
They mustn't stray too far.
Their wings are clipped and they start to lay, they settle down and they start to lay about the 1st of April. We carry on from there collecting the eggs and therefore another year to reproduce the pheasants, because in the wilds nowadays, if it was for the wild stock to be left out, I'm afraid everything would kill them and they would die out, the pheasants.
The fox, of course, is the pheasant's traditional enemy.
Now and again, we have to go out. A few of us, mostly the keepers, go out and destroy a few foxes, actually, by shooting them, because we find it is the best way of dealing with them. We watch them quite a lot early mornings, and we have to do something, otherwise the wildlife, the small birds, and everything would die out. Today is the end of January, which we have a beater shoot, which is for the chats that come all season, beated, picked up and done the stopping, and really been a help through the season. There's not quite so many birds, for them to shoot, as there would be early on in the season. But if they can get one bird out the day, they really enjoy it.
Go this way a little bit. Come this way a little bit. Well, we don't want to fall over in them bushes, anyhow. You never know. What about you, Bill?
Yeah.
Okay?
Smacking. Very good.
You all right on your nuts, are you? That's all right, then.
Got you there.
Right, can we have a... order, please? Just for a few minutes.
How's your diet, Pete?
Good.
I'd like to say one or two words that people have helped us through the season. First, I'd like to thank the four underkeepers for how hard they've worked this season. I'm really pleased with them. They've worked very hard. And I'm very, very pleased that our friend Harold Langridge has drove his tractor absolutely fantastic this year again. Even in the icy weather, he done fantastic. And we're really pleased with him. And also Sandy and Lynn for the flagging up. They still flag so well. Make them fly too high, that leave a few for our day.
True,
and that's
quite
what's
right.
Important.
I've trained them well.
Well. We've had a very good season. I'm ever so pleased and proud of all of you. Thank you very much. There's one more. There is one other thing I would like to say. Is thank you very much for Joyce for a marvellous meal.
One of Jack's skills is whittling and carving.
Come on, hang it.
Well, you want to cut your wood about Christmas time. And the subject for the stick, it wants to be cut. Put in a shed and forgot about for at least a year. And then you keep a year's supply in. But, it's no good cutting it when it's green, because the sap crinkles and it's soft. You must cut it in the winter time when the sap's down. And of course, that goes for hazel, ash, and a bit of cherry, if you like.
Thank you.
But the holly, which makes some of the best sticks, wants to be cut at the end of April, whereas you hardwood sticks must be cut after November.
Angus. Angus. Sit down. Sit. Here. Come on. Come on. Sit down.
You want a piece as thick as your leg, your thigh, with a good stout stick growing up from it, 5 foot long. When you cut them off, you cut the thick shank, which is like your thigh, 6 inches each side the stick. Otherwise, if you cut it, say, 2 inches each side the stick, it will crack in the process of drying and be no good for carving. And get where I can't get with my chisel with it. Well, the chisel has a flat long edge and this has broken corners, and some of those corners just fit in the right places. For instance, there, it gets in there where I would have to get my chisel in.
Do you ever cut yourself?
Yes, I do, badly. Not so much with this glass, but you've got to be careful, otherwise you can do it with the glass. I've got to have a smaller bit there.
What is the winter for you?
There's a lot of difference in winter for a young man and an old man. I mean, a young man doesn't bother about the winter. He loves it. Most people do, the snow and the ice, whereas when you get to my time, you don't want to see much snow and ice. I'd sooner sit here and have a good fire. But I think as one gets old, you really don't want the cold weather.
Wood earns money for the estate. Jack's eldest son, Kendrick, is in charge of the forestry.
Chestnuts always cut when the sap's dead. If you was to cut it in the summertime, when the sap was up, the wood wouldn't last very long. It would rot.
Mm.
So you always cut it sort of between November and the 31st of March. It's all supposed to be cut off the stub, you know, for the regrowth to start again.
Kendrick controls a team of a dozen men.
Howard Langridge has worked here 36 years and he can practically do any job in forestry he's asked to do. Some of the others, they learn quite a lot off him.
These faggots of birch are for brooms and horse jumps.
His father was a thatcher and they were brought up in the woods, the Langridge family, and anything to do with wood, spars, thatching spars, hurdles, anything they could do.
All the year round, Jack keeps himself in vegetables, grown in his own half acre.
Usually, Christmas Day or Boxing Day, I sow me broad beans. I always put a lot more than what's needed. For simple reason, I've got plenty of seed. I can afford to be liberal with them. There's always slugs want some. And in my garden, I get quite a few pheasants, and I have to allow a few for them. The dogs chase them up, but
There's always some up before I am in the morning and have a few of me beans, so there's a few allowed for them. When they were sowing the corn in the fields, and the old man walked along with his sowing bucket on his arm, he sowed with the right and left arm, one to rot, one to grow, one for the rook and one for the crow.
I get a lot of pleasure out of it, because if you've got the seeds in right and look at it right, you're almost guaranteed to get returns. It's not like a lot of other things. You work hard and there's nothing to it. Your garden returns what you give it. If you do it right, it'll do you right.
Jack Lewis's former boss, Richard Greenwood, still drops in regularly for tea, a chat, and a piece of Jack's cake.
Hello. Good afternoon, sir. What was on? Come on.
I thought they were going to... He just jumped the gate.
Who?
The first time I've ever seen that one jump the gate.
One.
Came... Happy Christmas.
Oh, thank you so much. That's my Christmas.
Yes. Listen, sorry it's a bit late.
You go and try to jump the gate.
I'm not going to. Come on, dogs. Come on.
That is good.
Yeah, you can open it in
a minute. No,
I won't
open it now.
You've got to.
No.
Go on, undo it. I haven't given it to you just to look at.
No, I won't wear it now.
Yeah, no, well, you haven't even looked at it, though. Well, go on, put it on, then.
All right.
It feels...
Turn around.
It feels warm, let alone anything, no?
Well, it should be. There you are.
Let's get in.
It's meant for you to wear when you're gardening, so that you get
smashing.
Keep the wind out of your kidneys.
That's absolutely
right. I say, you've put on a bit of
lovely
weight.
Lovely and long.
What?
Smashing it.
Well,
back.
Then I asked her to make it long.
That'll
for
keep
you.
Your bottom warm.
I might have one made myself now. Well, all right, cuppa. I'm dying.
Yes, so am I. Right?
Yeah, you know, terribly sad. You hear about Major Women, a couple of days ago?
No, I've not heard.
And he fell down in the snow at his house and hurt his leg and went to hospital and he didn't get better, and in the end, I'm afraid he died yesterday.
Good.
Terribly sad.
Good. What, yesterday?
Day before, actually.
Well, he's no age.
Well, I think he's a bit older than we think. I think he's nearly 70, you know. But that's no age. You won't be able to use, you know.
Everything I know wants to live, even human beings. If we know there's nothing, we still want to live. Why do people talk of survival? What's the point in it? Why do you want to survive? I mean, I've seen animals go through the most terrible things. I saw a hen pheasant as a young chap, a young keeper. There was an old man cutting some grass, two horses and a mowing machine, and he shouted at me. I was going up the hedgeside with my gun. He said, "Hey, come here, young chap." He said, "I've just cut a hen pheasant, look." He said, "Cut her legs off and she's flown away into the wood." And he said, "Look, there's the eggs," and there was 10 eggs. And he left a bit of grass, pulled the horses round, left some grass. And I went along the next day, and the old man wasn't there, and I went to look, and the hen pheasant was back on the eggs. And I made a point of going and look, and I saw that pheasant for weeks and weeks, and she reared 6 young ones, and she only had 2 stumps, and she went by the name of Stumpy. And she reared her little ones. And, it wants some doing, but she managed it.
Details of the music heard in their programme can be found on page 241 of Oracle.